Hello, welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. Excuse me. This is the RPG Chick, and this is a Let's Play series where you get to decide at the end what choice is to be taken next. At the end of last episode, well, we could either say Bananga or not. So this was revealed on a sign. Stop, traveler. Every wish can come true. For this post marks the grave of the god Bananga. Call his name and close your eyes to be blessed forthwith. And we did our telepathy or whatever for to see if there's any danger. And there is some danger here, but it doesn't specify what it is. The majority of the votes said to call the name Bananga. Which I don't believe has anything to do with bananas. But, yeah, so here we go. Bananga! Bazinga! You stand carefully by the post and call out Bananga to the empty air. Nothing seems to change. There is no sense of danger or of blessing in the air. I'm supposed to then close my eyes. Well, in the spirit of the votes, I'm going to continue. You close your eyes as the note instructed. Nothing happens. You sense no danger. Wait. What? You wait a moment longer with your eyes still closed. Then you feel something move under your feet. I'm gonna jump aside. Oh. You step away from the post just as the ground beneath the post gives way and collapses into the earth. You have avoided falling into the trap by mere moments. Wow. Thanks, guys. Luckily, my cat-like reflexes helped me out of this one. Do we dare to look down into the pit? You peer down the side of the pit. At the bottom, a small Badu beetle is burrowing. It works with its soft mandibles to fill in the pit with sand once more. If I go kill it, do we get into a battle, or can I just kill it outright because it's so small? Let's kill it. Maybe we can eat it for food. Leaning over the edge of the pit, you are easily able to reach down to stab with your sword. The tip of the blade pierces the beetle's soft, young carapace, and it dies swiftly, green blood oozing into the sands of the pit. You leave the side of the pit. You march on. Too funny. Alright, let's start moving towards this tower. South, sort of. You fall into a steady pace as you walk, ascending and descending. The evening is drawing in. You notice something white, stark, against the gray of the dust. Got it? It's just a sliver of cool white, visible through the thin, dusty scrub. Something is buried here. Clear the dust. You wipe away the dust from the object. It is short, dirty white, and gently curved. Watch, it's the next serpent. Dig up the item. You peer around the object and find two similar objects to the left and right of it. They lie parallel in the dirt. It's the coils of the serpent, isn't it? Keep digging. You squat down on your heels and dig in the dirt a little more. Eventually you uncover three short white rods. And at that moment it becomes obvious they are finger bones of a hand, clenched into a fist. The fist points upwards as if the owner had been buried standing upright in the soil. Keep digging. You keep digging. The fist gives way to a wrist, and then an arm. It is as though the creature was trying to climb out when the soil of the land closed over its head. You're like that trap we just found, the Bananga thing. As you go lower, the bones start to accumulate a leathery coating. At first you think it is the remains of a coat, but then once you locate an anchor and sail tattoo, it becomes clear it is skin. somehow preserved in the soil. Is this thing gonna attack us? A skeleton or zombie? Or half skeleton, half zombie? You are now into serious digging, which is hard work. You pause to take a break, or both, every few minutes and stop once more when you have the figure unearthed down to the waist. Its skull is a dried leather ball with two gray-brown eyes shrunken in the sockets. It wears a metal ring through its nose, and the remains of a beard are just visible. Its jacket is better preserved, its color faded, but its buttons still intact. It wears a small three-cornered hat. It sounds like a pirate or something. Sticking just above the waist are the remains of some kind of harness. It is possible this figure had a false leg. Search the figure. Oh, I lost a point of stamina doing this. You rifle through the figure's jacket, but find nothing of interest in its pockets, not even one gold piece. However, you find a small metal whistle, which you take. I got a whistle? A simple brass whistle. Huh. Okay. Take the hat. You take the hat from the creature's head, but it is of little use. It crumbles to dust in your hand. More interesting is what is left behind. Under the figure's thin covering of hair, you can see a dry, leathery scalp inked with another tattoo. Look at that. You examine the tattoo carefully. It shows two thick lines that come together to form a V. At the top, another stroke crosses so that the shape becomes an inverted A. Inside the top of the A near the tip is a black X inside an O. Perhaps it is a map, but if so, it is surely too vague to read. There was something on the sand back I don't even know if it's in this area. I think it's down near that post where that old man was inside. I got dragged away by the bird. I keep digging, I guess. Oh my god, it lost more stamina. The sun lowers toward the horizon. It will be night soon. You work harder still, creating a deep pit and getting down as far as the figure's knees. One leg is indeed wooden, the other trouser-clad bone. I've gone this far. Oh my god, we're gonna die from this. I have one stamina. The sun is now in the lowest quarter of the sky. Soon it will be dark. You dig down to the figure's feet, so it is standing proud in a 5-foot hole. Water begins to pool around your feet. The sun has all but gone. The figure keels over, face down, against the dirt. You have wasted a lot of time unburying it, but have discovered nothing. Good god, we have one stamina. Okay. You haul yourself up out of the pit and leave the figure, standing in its hollow like a ghoulish statue. Wait, you just said it keeled over face down against the dirt, now it's standing? Suddenly the creature in the pit begins to shiver and shake. It is moving, arms reaching out to grasp you. Skewer it? Skewer it? With what? You draw your sword and quickly skewer the thing through its skull. It shivers for a moment, hands reaching up to clutch the blade that has entered through its socket. Then it collapses and falls still. Look at it. The figure's boots are glistening wet with the water that has pooled into the pit. There must be an underground river somewhere near here. The water itself seems to gleam and sparkle. Scoop up some water in the gourd. You reach down past the nasty figure and fill the gourd with water. Ooh, the way it sparkles as it moves makes it quite clear. This is not ordinary water. It is holy. There must be a sacred site nearby. You move away from this ghoulish thing. Can I drink the water? A It's not here. Water gourd. Drink. We have one stamina. It seems like a good time to drink it. Nice. You drink the water in the gourd. 5. The gourd is empty. Easy come, easy go. Unfortunately, we're still down from where we were. I mean, we were at 7, I believe. Let's go here first to this circle of whatever this is. Probably trouble. Eh. You march onwards, climbing slightly. Another night begins, and you are worn out. You need to rest, especially after so much walking on an empty stomach. The sudden sound of voices to your right startles you. Ground. You spin around to see 7 hooded shapes silhouetted against the dark. They form a circle, squatting on the ground, playing some sort of weird game, chanting in a curious tongue. I definitely don't want to be fighting all these. There's 7 of them. Look at them. Are they playing, swindle stones? I'm gonna look at them. You rub your eyes in disbelief. The figures shimmer, and it seems you can see through them. And they were certainly not here a moment before. One raises its head and stares straight at you, then calls to you by name. We have awaited you, it breathes. You have made good time to us. We are the 7 spirits. Come. Join us. Okay. I'm gonna approach. The 7 spirits, as opposed to the 7 serpents? Warily you approach. Who are these creatures? How do they know your name? Will they offer advice, or are they dangerous, as their skull mask faces suggest? The spirits rise from the ground as you approach, gliding silently through the air, passing through one another as they mingle and encircle you, linking hands. Caution is understandable, whispers a single voice, or 7 in tight unison, but fear us not. What are you? These bodies are not our natural bodies, merely shells, the voice declares. We cannot touch you. We cannot harm you. So what are your natural bodies, the serpents? Long dead, whispers the voice. We died. Learning a chant to protect you from harm. You must hear it. Well, this is curious. I'm curious about this, but it seems kind of demanding, doesn't it? Tell me the chant. The spirits begin to turn and dance around you, chanting in a whispering unison, but you cannot understand the words. Repeat, they hiss. Sing with us. Repeating words in a language you cannot understand is difficult. You try, but stumble over the first few lines. I'd cast a spell to see if there's danger, but I only have 5 stamina. Arbil Madarbil. The chant begins again. This time you get a little further. Ar afar, ar cry. Another round, and this time you get further, though you still don't know what it is you are chanting. Noi dolomine. Silence is settling over the area, a strange, unnatural silence. Something is coming? You sing the chant in full, louder and more confidently. The clouds begin to churn in the sky. Then a loud crack breaks the stillness as a bolt of lightning skewers the place where the 7 spirits stand. The light clears, and they have vanished. I guess I have a reason to look to the sky. You look up. The sky overhead seems to be breaking. The dome of the sky is now a lidded eye, cracking open. Something like a clawed hand has hold of you and is pulling you toward the top of the low mound. The ground itself is transforming into a face, and you are walking into its wide-open smile. Huh. Let's pray. You close your eyes and pray fervently to the God of Grace, but feel nothing. You are not heard. Something about this place has left you without your God, and at the last moment You realize you must be standing on holy ground, but holy to some terrible deity. Isn't that always the way? Then you are above the wide open jaws in the place of the face in the ground. You are to be devoured. Strike back. You raise the sword to swing, but stumble back under the weight of it. Your arms seem unable to lift the blade. But no, looking down, you see your legs are suddenly thin and your hands are thin and bony. Reaching up to your face, you find your hair is coming away in clumps and wrinkles are spreading over your skin. The serpent face in the ground laughs. The jaws of time are unescapable. It roars. What kind of spell can we cast? You look up to the heavens, intending to cast a spell, but you cannot see the stars anymore. Your eyes have grown blurry and unfocused. And the night swims as if you were underwater. You tumble to the ground, and you hear the snap as the bones in your hip and pelvis give out. The serpent shifts closer. Well, this isn't looking very well, is it? I don't think this is going very, very well for us. Ask for mercy. You open your mouth to cry out, and your teeth scatter to the ground. A moment later, you cannot see. Another moment, and you are nothing but a skeleton. You stare out through bone-dead eyes, cold, dry bones. You are nothing but cold bones. But then the winds drop once more. The clouds roll back. The steps are clearing. You feel yourself becoming young once more, bones strengthening and skin tightening. Whatever was pulling you towards death has released its grip. You turn to see a gigantic shape lift into the ground and swoop away northeast. It leaves a strange trail as it flies, and the wind from its movement knocks you to the ground. You stagger backwards, glad to be alive and keen to leave this accursed place. Okay, well, that was unusual. Let's go to this. I think we can heal ourselves to full with these towers. Seems like a good time to do that. You set off across the steps with an easy stride, but the firm, dusty ground becomes spongy, and after a while, you are no longer walking on firm ground, but rather striding between waist-high weeds in a deep and stench-filled marsh. The moon moves slowly across the sky like a lidless eye. You approach the edge of the mountains and the base of an old stone tower, carved from the cliff face itself. From the battlements of the tower protrudes a strange brass cylinder. Nestled between the stones is a large, closed wooden door. Let's knock first. You never know. There might be someone living at one of these towers. You knock on the door. There is no reply. Enter. You try the door to the tower. It is locked, but the wood is ancient and rotten, and could most likely be easily broken. Break down the door. You take a run up, then charge at the door, smashing through and tumbling to the floor inside. We weren't able to actually get inside the other tower, but we had to climb to the top with our, you know, giant form. Spell. Oh. Great, this really is not the time. We're pretty much equally matched, aren't we? 5 and 5. You pick yourself up off the ground to find yourself staring into the snarling jaws of a wolfhound. It is clearly half mad with starvation. There is no time, and no choice but to fight. Start off strong. Good. Oh, wow. Nice. The wolfhound creeps toward you across the flagstones, jaws dropping and fur shining wet. It will not listen to reason. You charge headlong. It bounds forward, only to run itself onto your blade, writhing and howling. As the wolfhound grows weaker, its snarl gets madder. Nice. That was awesome. That was so easy. You put all your strength into the swing of your blade, hoping to finish the creature in a stroke. The strike connects. As the wolfhound weakly opens its jaws to bite, you plunge your blade between its teeth and all the way down to its heart. The wolfhound howls, a gurgling, blood-soaked sound that rings inside the tower. And then it dies. No stamina lost. Flawless fighting. You wipe your long sword and gasp for breath as you look around the room. The wide tower base is empty except for a flight of spiral stairs leading up to a hatch in the ceiling overhead. Search the shadows. You try to ignore the smell of wet blood that fills the chamber, I guess from the wolfhound, and search the gloomy arches under the spiraling staircase. In a forgotten corner you will unearth 3 gold pieces and a strange mass of green fur. Take everything. Ooh! Ooh, I know what that's for! The wig. You put the gold into your purse and the fur, which turns out to be a wig, into your pack. Time to leave this gloomy place. Sweet. So the fur, I can tell you, because now we have 16 gold, that's cool. That's a magical item. Green-haired wig. For... it's not that. I'm trying to find that spell. The music just stopped. Requires a pull ring. Green-haired wig, I found it. Wrap. You have to wear the wig. Allows the caster to understand the language of and communicate with creatures speaking a non-human tongue. Cool. Up the steps. You clamber up the spiral steps to the hatch and go through onto the roof of the tower. The cool wind of the steps hits you full in the face, snatching your breath away. The tower stands on the slope of one of the horns themselves, looking out over the whole of the steps. So, set into the floor here is a bearing track on which a brass cylinder rests. A blue crystal is set into its length. There are powerful, unusual stars here. Look at the contraption. The cylinder is similar to the one you saw earlier, though this one has been carefully designed to slip in and out between the tree branches in a fairly complicated way. Activate. It takes a moment of fiddling to find the correct place on the contraption to bring the beam to life, but once it does, it sweeps out of the cylinder and across the land. Alright, so stuff. Was it already facing this way? No. So by using this, we go back in time, obviously. See the forest of Snatta becomes... It's so hard to control this for some reason, I don't know. Something swamp. Vishlami swamp. So I'm not done yet, so let's focus it away, because I want to see what that house is, that farmhouse or whatever. You adjust the contraption's position and focus carefully, watching the land shift and change. Ooh, see that? 15, not completely full, but... under its light as you make your adjustments. Finally satisfied, you set the lantern into one of the crenellations of the turret and step back. Where the light touches you, you feel suddenly much better. Touch the blue crystal? You touch the blue crystal and suddenly you feel yourself ascending. Cool. Alright, so two towers activated. A moment later, you are tumbling downwards from the sky, the wind rushing past your face. You are certain to shatter into a thousand pieces, and then suddenly you are on the ground once more. You find yourself on top of a tower carved from a steep mountainside. The cylinder here is lit up, shining its strange light over the land. It takes a moment for you to regain your breath. Incredible. So we're facing that way. Alright. I wonder if we should rest here. Why not? You could not choose a better place to rest. You close the hatch and lie down on top of it. Nothing will accost you now, unless it has wings. Don't even say that. You have not yet eaten today, but you have no rations to ease your hunger. You close your eyes and let your tiredness overtake you. You seem guarded here, and you do not dream. Top of the tower, day 7. During the past day, you changed to using the longsword, +2, gained a little gold, +1, entered the Vishlani Marsh, and found no new clues. You wake after a peaceful night and gather up your pack once more. We didn't go in the marsh, we went into the woods. Oh. You go over to the battlement and lean out. Looking north, you can see the edge of the thick and verdant forest, the fabled trees of Snatta. Yeah, not the marsh. You heard about them as a girl, of course, but never dreamed you would see them for yourself. Between here and there is nothing but the level flats of the steps, layered like the scales on a serpent's back. A thin column of smoke rises from a point just before the tree line. It must be the village of the Clattermen. You look away from the view once more. You climb down the stairs to the base of the tower. The door at the tower base is open and looks out onto a soggy marsh. Time to move along. Well, wait, how do I change back? You step out of the tower once more. You are still some distance from the shores of Lake Ilklala, and the voyage you must take across its waters to Lower Zeman. The mountains to the east are impassable. The only way to walk is back across the rocks. Okay, well, this is still here, this home. Okay, let's stay away from this thing. You are walking through boggy marshland. The air moves a little, still icy, but fresh. The ground underfoot turns to slop, until you are sinking a few fingers deep with every step. A thick smell of rot and decay fills the air. Great. Look around. The marsh is endless, bleak and gray, filling the valley between the ridge and the horns of Ilklala like a slop filling a prisoner's bowl. Long grasses waft and shiver in the still breeze. Things move in the water below. From somewhere close at hand you hear a crashing noise and a cry. But you can see nothing. Test the marsh with my sword. You draw your sword and spike the ground on either side. Some areas are quite shallow, but others seem to sink a good depth down. The ground here is clearly treacherous. Wait. You wait to see if the noise comes closer, but it does not. You cannot even place which direction it came from. You keep up your pace, hoping the ground will grow firmer further on. Alright, let's go to the ruin. I guess we make it there safely. The marshes give way to more solid, barren ground. As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. Something is visible in the distance to the south. Perhaps man-made, or perhaps a freak of nature, carved from the rocks. but it resembles a low stone building. Yes, I've been interested in this place. The temple, behind the temple, or the well. Let's head to the temple. You go closer until you can see more clearly what the structure is, or what it was, a ruined building standing on a stone plinth, its columns cracked and broken. The elaborate carvings on the pillars suggest it was once a temple of some kind, but it is 100 times more desolate now than the broken shrine where you found Theta and Kare. Let's go to this well first. No, actually, let's go behind the temple. Wells generally will give you hit points back. We're only missing two, so I'd rather, like, maybe be missing more when I go to the well. That's my bet, anyway. You walk around the back of the structure. The east side is in no better repair. Wind blows through holes in the walls. In one corner, you notice a strange, almost rectangular impression in the dust. Look at it. Kneeling on the old stone, you brush the dust away from the rectangular impression with careful fingertips. There's definitely something here set into the old stone, a trap door. Sand blows across the steps and into your eyes, making you blink. Open. You grasp the handle of the ancient trap door and give it a good heave. The hinges squeal and cry, but the trap door opens, revealing a few steps downwards and a disgusting smell. And you can hear something down there, moving around. Peer down. You peer down into the darkness below. Two eyes are staring back, and you can hear a ragged, rasping breathing. Alright, guys, I'm gonna leave it here. Let me know what I should do. Should I close the trap door? Forget about this thing with the ragged breathing? Should I call down? Try to draw whatever it is up to me? Or should I climb down, fighting the creature in its own territory? Whatever it is. Alright, so we're closing the trap door, calling down to it, or climbing down to it. Which will most probably be a fight. But let me know what you guys think, and hope to see you in the next episode. And don't forget to leave your votes, and endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.